my sister Kirsten introduced me to Laura Nyro, and the thing that attracted me about it was the kind of alternate reality world that she creates with her words and with her the sounds. It became kind of part of the fabric of how I compose music, how I conceive of music.
Billy, when I first met him, had, I believe that he introduced me to the music of Laura Nyro. We were good friends, and during that time, I think he introduced me to Laura Nyro's music, and I loved it.
I can't even describe it, you know. She just played to her own drum, and there were things that happened within songs that didn't make sense but were amazing.
Most singer-songwriters set up a sort of tempo and a beat, and they adhere to that particular piece of the school of popular songwriting. She absolutely doesn't do that. But she also writes these things that are completely internal and have an improvisatory feeling to them.
When Billy called with the idea of collaborating on this, I thought it was a fantastic idea because it was a long time coming for us to come back together and make a record together. In an aesthetic sense, we sort of had grown to inhabit opposite sides of a continuum musically, in that, as Billy put it, he was a maximalist and I was a minimalist. And
I think her music actually inhabits both worlds, like the maximal world and the minimal world. I mean, you listen to a track like New York Tenderberry, and it's a very intimate, almost like love letter to New York.
Tenderberry, rash on rum of brush and drum, and the past is a blue note.
A piece like Gibson Street, which, you know, starts with solo piano, all of a sudden you have these blazing horns, you know, and drum sets and electric guitars, and it's very densely orchestrated, and to me, those contrasts are really interesting in that they bring this theatrical element to her music that I find really heightens the drama of what she's talking about.
When Billy called me and asked me if I wanted to be a part of this project, I was really excited to finally get to know her music and also to get to know her through the lens of Billy.
Would you love to love me, baby? I would love to love you, baby. Now, baby, now. Mama, it's my pain.
There isn't really a reason to do a record like this unless one can reinvent the song in a way that takes it far enough away from the original version that the composer and writer to have people see the thing in a completely new way, so that they hear the lyric in a new sense, and so that they find some different things inside the song they might not hear on the iconic version.
A lot of what she's talking about is not straightforward, like this is this and that's that, this guy did this to me, that girl did that to me, you know. It's more symbolic, you know, and very poetic and allegoric.
I think it's great for young artists or older artists, you know, like myself, to be exposed to music from the greats, you know, and so I think any time that people get to hear the classic music, whether it's reinterpreted or in its original form, is fantastic.
It was really going to be hard for me to conceive of an album with a singer that covered all of the different areas that Laura did.
And then when it came to selecting which artists would be the vocalists on each song, the same thing would happen. You know, we would kind of sit and talk and say, well, you know, what if we had this person, they would bring this to the song, or this person would be more of a contrast to the overt meaning of the lyric. Their voice would have a different effect on this lyric.
A lot of musicians, a lot of singers loved Laura Nyro's music. Patti LaBelle loved her music, and she loved them. She loved soul music, and she was the whole package.
It's not going to be a regurgitation of Laura Nyro, so it's going to be, you know, a reimagining. I guess that's the best way to put it.